Thank you. The next item of business is a statement by Angela Constance on response to Storm Babet. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, I am very grateful for the opportunity to update Parliament on the exceptional weather Scotland experienced last week as a consequence of Storm Babet. I would like to begin by expressing condolences to the families and friends of those who have lost their lives due to the extreme conditions caused by the storm. I also want to express my sympathy for those whose homes and businesses have been damaged by the extensive flooding. I would like to thank and pay tribute to the local and national authorities, volunteers, the emergency services and members of the public themselves for all of their hard work and efforts in these extremely challenging conditions. I would also like to highlight the very impressive community response to offer support to all those affected by the floods. Angus Council received hundreds of offers of alternative accommodation for those who were forced to evacuate their homes. This is a testament to the strong community networks in Scotland who are there to support one another. On Thursday, the 19th of October, the Met Office took the serious step of issuing a red weather warning of threat of life. The Met Office issue these warnings when dangerous weather is expected, with substantial disruption and the possibility of widespread damage to property and infrastructure. Red weather warnings are extremely rare and extremely serious. The Met Office's National Climate Information Centre has calculated that on the 19th of October 2023 was provisionally the wettest day for the County of Angus in a series from 1891. And the 7th of October 2023 was the sixth wettest day in that series. So these have been exceptional rainfall amounts across the Angus area. Serious impacts were felt across Scotland, but were felt most keenly along the north and south Esk, including Brechin, where the flood protection scheme unfortunately overtopped and was subsequently breached. Nonetheless, the flood protection scheme still delayed the impact and provided valuable time to prepare for evacuation. Nearly 350 properties in Brechin were evacuated on Thursday afternoon. And Angus Council and SEPA are assessing the extent of the damage to the Brechin flood protection scheme. But we know that the flooding has also had an impact on communities in parts of Aberdeenshire, Tayside and Dundee. The process of assessing the full amount of damage caused by Storm Babet will take time. There will be a long road to recovery, but Scottish Government will support our partners to ensure communities can recover as quickly as possible. The Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance agreed the activation of the Bellwins scheme on Tuesday, the 24th of October. The Bellwins scheme exists to give special financial assistance to councils who face an undue financial burden as a result of large-scale emergencies. To date, three local authorities have notified the Scottish Government of a potential claim relating to the storm. The Scottish Government stands ready to support local authorities to carry out the immediate work required. We also recognise that communities and homeowners will be seeking to make vital repairs to secure their homes. Crisis grants are available through the Scottish Welfare Fund to families and people in Scotland who are on low incomes and have been hit by a crisis such as a flood, and people can apply for a grant through their local authorities. The Scottish Government has funded the Scottish Flood Forum since 2009 to work with communities to build flood resilience and support those affected by flooding. This forum, who offered free advice and information on issues such as recovering from flooding, is working with communities that were affected by Storm Babet. We are facing a climate crisis, and although no single storm event can be solely attributed to climate change, events like Storm Babet are becoming more frequent, more intense and more destructive due to the changing climate. Storm Babet reinforces the need to think strategically about Scotland's future and what we need to do to adapt to our changing climate. The Scottish Government supports local authorities to deliver actions that protect our communities and businesses. We have committed an additional £150 million over the course of this Parliament, on top of the £42 million provided annually to councils to increase flood resilience through the General Capital Grant. Flood protection schemes are one important tool to help our communities become more flood resilient, and this year three new flood protection schemes have been completed in Coolin Lochieside, Arbroath and Stonehaven. This infrastructure is a crucial part of our flood resilience approach, but it is not the only tool available to us. We are taking action across agriculture, transport, forestry, water industry and planning sectors, integrating flood resilience measures into policies to deliver multiple benefits. The Agri-Environment Climate Scheme promotes land management practices which protect and enhance Scotland's natural heritage, manage flood risk and adapt to climate change. To date, £285 million has been committed to over 3,000 businesses. Transport Scotland are spending more than £2 million a year on drainage improvement schemes and a watercourse realignment scheme to enhance the flood resilience of Scotland's road network. Forestry Scotland estimate that the capacity of woodlands to store water and slow down runoff to downstream communities is worth almost £100 million a year to the Scottish economy. And their new Woodland for Riparian Benefits Forestry Grant Scheme opened in July 2023, offering grant support for woodland creation near rivers. Around 175,000 hectares of land has been identified for woodland planting, all with the potential to slow the flow of flooding, among numerous other benefits. To future-proof our developments against climate change, the National Planning Framework 4 aims to strengthen flood resilience by making it much harder to build in areas of risk of flooding by supporting the protection and management of our important natural assets in a sustainable, regenerative way and by promoting the use of natural flood management and blue-green infrastructure. However, despite all the good work to date by Scottish Government and responsible authorities, our changing climate means that flooding impacts are still on the increase, and we recognise that our current approach to delivering flood management actions is not keeping pace with this. Indeed, events at the weekend are a reminder that climate change is not a far-off, distant threat. It's a crisis that is here and now. We also know our climate will continue to change for many years to come. The decisions that we make today have to stand the test of time. So in January, we will start consulting on a new national adaptation plan. We have a lot to gain by understanding Scotland is well positioned to continuing to thrive in the face of changing global climate. And this plan will set out the tools available to ensure lives and livelihoods are adapting well to the impacts of climate change. Fundamental to our approach to climate adaptation is responding to the increasing impacts of flooding, Scotland's biggest climate adaptation challenge and one that is set to become more difficult in the years to come. Meeting this challenge will require a Team Scotland approach involving a broad range of delivery partners to ensure our places and communities can continue to thrive in the face of a climate emergency. Our new National Flood Resilience Strategy will form an integral part of shaping a climate-resilient Scotland. And the strategy will look ahead through to 2045 and beyond and capture the big issues that need to be addressed if we are to transition towards a sustainable level of flood resilience in our changing climate. The impacts in Brechin, despite having flood protection built to a high standard, illustrate that we cannot always protect our communities from all flood impacts 100% of the time, and that we should be considering all actions that can be implemented to increase flood resilience. This has been, Presiding Officer, an exceptionally challenging few days. We should not underestimate the impact severe weather events have on our families and our communities, and it is critical that we take action to mitigate the impact of future events, and the Scottish Government will continue to do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes four questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. And it would be helpful if those members who would wish to ask a question could please press the request to speak button now. And I call Tess White.
Cabinet Secretary, I'd like to associate with the tributes to the people who tragically lost their lives in Storm Babet. And I pay tribute to the frontline responders, emergency services, individuals and businesses and community organisations who have worked tirelessly to support the affected communities. From River Street in Brechin to the North East Caravan Park in St Cyrus, scores of people are homeless, with little prospect of return in the coming months. Like so many others across the North East, my own home in the Mearns has been badly damaged by the severity of the storm. Families are living in Airbnbs and on the goodwill of others. The flood defence scheme in Angus that cost £16 million in 2016 was all but swept away in a matter of hours. Infrastructure needs to be repaired and significant changes made in the vicinity of South Esk. There are massive issues with coastal erosion and flood damage to farms in Montrose. These need to be addressed. The bill could run into millions of pounds. So my three questions to the Cabinet Secretary, if I may, is, does the Cabinet Secretary believe the funds available through the Belwyn scheme will touch the sides of this crisis? And two, how will the Scottish Government work with insurance firms to help residents hit by flooding, as Humza Yousaf has committed to do? And three, what support is available to Angus Council to rehome those who are not returning to River Street for months? Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I am well aware that Ms White will be, through her own personal experience, aware of the damage and the trauma and how frightening it is to be a victim of flooding and the dangers of rapidly rising water. And like her, we should always pay tribute to those who have lost their life. There have been three lives lost in Scotland, and there are reports of four lives lost elsewhere in the UK. Of course, people will have protections under homelessness legislation, and the Scottish Government and our housing colleagues will continue to support Angus Council with regards to that. In terms of the flood defence scheme, it is important to recognise that it was built to a very high standard. It has in the past did the job that it was designed to do. On this occasion, it didn't. But it is worth remembering that it did delay the deluge and it did allow valuable time for an evacuation. But nonetheless, there needs to be an assessment to what those repair costs will be. As I said in my statement, that the Belwyn scheme is now operational. There will need to be an assessment of the damage at local level and, of course, there will be sympathetic discussions between the Scottish Government and the local areas. And I can confirm that the Scottish Government has indeed been in touch with the Association of Insurers, the British Association of Insurers, because we need a timeous and sympathetic response to those in need. And we'll continue to engage very closely with our colleagues in Angus.
Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Minister for advance notice of her statement? Scottish Labour also sends our condolences to the families who have lost a loved one. These floods have had a devastating impact on people's homes, on businesses and farming communities. I do also want to thank the emergency services and the communities for coming together to support people in their time of need. And I welcome the fact the Belwyn scheme has been activated to support local authorities, given the scale of the damage caused. But lessons must be urgently learned. The Brechin scheme was only built 7 years ago and was designed to deal with a 1 in 200 years incident. So we urgently need to understand why it did fail to protect the communities it was designed to serve. That's critical in terms of new infrastructure being planned. So could the Cabinet Secretary say what the timescale is for publishing that analysis on why the damage was so severe? What work's been done to review existing and planned infrastructure on flood prevention? And what will be done to accelerate flood resilience to support the communities, businesses and farmers? And finally, I agree that the climate crisis will lead to more extreme and unpredictable weather. So could the Minister say how we will make sure all our transport infrastructure, road and rail, is resilient and equipped to deal with the more extreme weather we will face?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signing officer, there's a lot in Ms Boyack's question, and if I don't respond to all her points, I'm happy to correspond in further detail, or indeed ask some of my colleagues to do that. I mean, the reason that, in short, that the damage was so severe was because the weather was so severe. You know, we've had two storms within 2 weeks, and in 2 days, there was 2 months' worth of rainfall. But the point she raises about learning the lessons, I absolutely concur with, because the Brechin scheme, it was a scheme where the Scottish Government contributed 80% of the cost. Now, these engineering projects are a vital part, but they are one, they're only one part of an overall plan. And we need to have that learning so that going forward, we can assess where these engineering projects will be most beneficial and where they can be targeted at the areas of most risk. But in short, the engineering solutions are only one part of the solution, and I hope that I have managed to speak to that in my statement today. Her points about farmers is very important. Our farmers and food producers are at the front line of climate change and the climate emergency. And I would also appeal to retailers and supermarkets to be very responsive and respectful and, where possible, sympathetic to the needs of farmers and food producers. There is a range of support that is available in terms of the Agricultural Benevolent Fund, the Agri-Environment Climate Scheme, but also, I think the member also touched upon the importance of our National Flood Resilience Strategy, which needs to capture all of the actions that we must pursue.
I call John Swinney to be followed by Maurice Golden. Mr Swinney.
Presiding officer, during the recent extreme weather events that had significant effects in my own constituency, including the tragic death of my constituent Wendy Taylor, a number of flooding problems were thankfully avoided by the outstanding efforts and intervention of local volunteer resilience groups who have tried and tested experience of managing these situations, such as in Aberfeldy and Aileth, to name just two, who worked in collaboration with public sector responders. Will the government commit to building into future resilience plans the vital role that volunteer-based organisations can play in supporting communities to deal with the awful effects of flooding and take practical steps to offer the necessary support to make this happen?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signing officer, the short answer is yes, and I echo the member's comments and thanks and pay tribute to the resilient volunteers in his constituency and across the North East who have been, as he says, outstanding. Voluntary and community sector organisations are valued participants alongside statutory response organisations in our resilient structures and the processes in planning, responding and also in recovery from emergencies. And to assist them, the Scottish Government Emergency Planning Portal, Ready.Scotland, has been updated to include a new section designed to support and help community groups, voluntary sector partners and the public to understand how they can participate in an effective and joined up response to emergencies. And I can also advise Presiding Officer that my resilience officials have been running a series of online community resilience workshops which have been joined to date by 240 participants. And we will continue to work with voluntary and community sectors and in particular local authorities who have the lead role in engaging with local communities to understand their training needs and provide additional resources if required.
I call Maurice Golden to be followed by Karen Adam. Mr Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It is vital that the public follows official guidance, particularly with regard to a red weather warning, the highest level of alert, to help preserve life and aid the emergency services. Many stakeholders worked hard to communicate those messages to support residents and businesses to take the right actions. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline what additional steps the Scottish Government is considering to help local authorities, emergency services and others to reinforce communication channels for future incidents?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding officer, Mr Golden raises an excellent point, and it's a fundamental point, because this was the first red alert that this country had since 2015, since Storm Desmond. And we need communication at each and every level. I would contend that the communication at a national level was effective. And where support was needed, I know that some of the emergency services supplemented communication support and communications officer support to local authorities where that was needed and requested. And that's one of the benefits of having a resilient structure that operates at both a local, regional and national level, that we can all chip in and support each other and direct that support where it's required. But there is, again, it's the point that Ms Boyack raised about important learning. And one of the things that I am particularly interested, bearing in mind there are instances of people not following advice, is that we need to look in more detail about what are the barriers to people following advice and how do we increase the prospects of people following advice, not just through our many, many communications channel, but it's also about who and how communicates messages that are ultimately can be very destabilising and frightening. But it's an excellent point and it's one that I will definitely be pursuing.
I call Karen Adam to be followed by Mercedes Bialba. Ms Adam.
Officer, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her statement and for paying tribute to those who went above and beyond during these storms. As a representative of the North East, I know the harsh impact that extreme weather events like Babet have on the energy and food security of rural communities. With each extreme weather event, we often see deliveries of goods delayed and shelves in supermarkets remaining empty. Will the Scottish Government commit to ensuring that the energy and food security of rural communities like mine of Bampshire and Buchan Coast are built into their future resilience plans, and to ensure that power cuts are minimised and shelves restocked in good time?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, we know that extreme weather events can be extremely disruptive to supermarket operations, and empty shelves can, you know, sometimes represent that sensible behaviours from citizens who've been acknowledging weather warnings and are preparing themselves for disruption. So the well-being of people in an emergency has to be that key and central part of resilience planning. Access to food is, of course, one element of that, and we will continue to seek opportunities to support and improve this. And food features significantly as an issue in the Scottish Government resilience meetings, and we have well-established routes and relationships with key stakeholders, including supermarkets, to monitor supplies and the potential issues. But we have, over the years, learned a lot about managing supplies, not least through the COVID pandemic. With regards to energy resilience, while the energy sector is reserved to the UK, nonetheless, as a government, we work very closely with the UK government and the energy network operators. And I have to say, while there was power outages and substantial disruptions, the energy companies and the energy sector worked very hard to ensure that over 30,000 households were reconnected as quickly as possible.
I call Mercedes Bialba to be followed by Evelyn Tweed. Ms Bialba.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to offer my condolences to everyone who's lost loved ones and who has been affected by the devastating impact of Storm Babet. Extreme weather events like last week's storm will only become more frequent and more severe and will continue to mourn victims of climate change around the world unless we act. But the Scottish Government has already admitted to breaching its statutory climate duties and has already missed four of its last five emissions targets. So can the Minister assure my constituents in the North East region that her government will meet its next emissions reduction target?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, my understanding is that it's this Parliament that has a duty to work together to ensure that we as a nation do everything possible to meet our pivotal climate change targets. This government will always aim high, and I'm sure this Parliament will always hold us to account. But I do agree with the member that this storm, and indeed other frequent storms, emphasise once again that climate change is not some distant future event. It is with us here and now. And in terms of our crucial future actions, the consultation that will be undertaken on the National Adaptation Plan, it will be crucially important, as will the National Flood Resilience Strategy that will be published next year. But also crucially is us all working together, not just across government, but across this Parliament and also across this nation.
I call Evelyn Tweed to be followed by Willie Rennie. Ms Tweed.
Presiding Officer, my condolences to the families and friends of those who died in Storm Babet. In my constituency, areas such as Aberfoyle and Callander regularly flood. Discussions on large-scale flood defence schemes have been ongoing for some time. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what support is available to residents and business owners to help reduce the risk of damage to their properties whilst they await progress on flood defence schemes?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the responsibility for the development and delivery of flood protection schemes rests with individual local authorities who are best placed to respond to those local resilient needs. Nonetheless, in terms of the support, the Scottish Government continues to fund the Scottish Flood Forum. We have done since 2009. That includes £220,000 of support for this financial year. And the purpose of that investment is to enable the forum to work with communities to build resilience and to support those who have been affected by flooding. And as I mentioned in my statement, they provide invaluable advice on property flood resilience and encourage families and businesses to prepare a flood emergency plan and to have a flood kit and prepared, and for communities to set up flood resilience groups. For those who have experienced flooding, they can also get individual advice and information. Some of that is in and around managing insurance claims, as well as dealing with the practical impacts. And I also referred in my statement, Presiding Officer, that the Scottish Welfare Fund is available with the Crisis Grant Scheme for those who are on a low income, and that can be accessed via local authorities.
I would advise the Chamber I have five more members who wish to ask a question. In order to get everybody in, which I would like to do, I will need much shorter answers, Cabinet Secretary, with respect, and short questions as well, please. I call Willie Rennie to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thankfully, we've avoided deaths in North East Fife, but I've witnessed the distress caused by flooding just in recent weeks in places like Fruity Mill. I've been working with farmers for some time now about the climate extremes in terms of drought, but also flooding, and I know the schemes that the Minister set out in her statement. But can I urge her to explore whether those schemes are flexible enough to cover both flooding but also drought on things like reservoirs, which can help for the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I will indeed speak to my colleague Ms Goujon to ensure that our schemes are as flexible as possible. And I know that Mary Goujon has been engaged with the sector, with the farming community and food providers in terms of a range of round tables. But the point he makes about that this isn't just flooding, that it's also about water scarcity as well, is a point that is well made.
I call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, and I also pay tribute to all the responders and communities involved in Storm Babet and extend my deepest sympathies to the families of those who lost their lives. Given the harrowing scenes that emerged of the extensive damage Storm Babet caused to people's homes, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what initial discussions have taken place with the Association of British Insurers that I understand have deployed extra resources into contact centres and on the ground in order to assist people, both those affected now but also those who might be affected in the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Association of British Insurers has been in ongoing discussions with Scottish Government resilience and flooding officials and have set out a range of measures that the insurance industry is taking to support affected communities as quickly and sympathetically as possible. These include deploying staff to flood hit areas and preparing to make emergency payments to flooded households. They are also working with the Scottish Flood Forum, which is an independent Scottish Government-funded charity, to produce an advice document for the public called Responding to Floods, What You Need to Know. That's available on the ABI website. And the ABI have also, I believe, proactively shared materials with MPs and MSPs in affected areas.
I call Rachel Hamilton to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Presiding Officer, potato crops were flooded, livestock washed away, and newly sown fields destroyed. Farmers have been left to carry the can or rely on support from RSABI or Forage Aid. So will the Scottish Government commit to supporting farmers wherever they can, in whatever way they can, and include them food producers and suppliers in a Storm Babet resilience review to ensure their losses are considered and that food supply chains will be protected in the future.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I would indeed like to reassure Ms Hamilton that Ms Goujon will be taking forward a range of discussions. As I intimated earlier, our farmers very much are on the front line of the climate change and climate challenge that we face. I know that Ms Goujon is in regular contact with NFUS President Martin Kennedy and that she will continue a programme of engagement, and it is right that those voices and the needs of those who are managing their land are heard, as we all need to work together to minimise the impact of what will certainly be more frequent weather events.
And I call Maggie Chapman.
I too send my heartfelt condolences to the families and friends of those who lost their lives, and I pay tribute to all those involved in the response, particularly in Angus and Mearns. Thank you for providing rescue, support, supplies, welfare checks and so much more. The Cabinet Secretary will know that we must consider what residents and businesses need now, but also longer-term mitigations, defences and adaptations. Can she say more about how we can support communities to become more resilient over and above the physical defences and infrastructure that we know we need?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, we will continue to work with the voluntary and community sector and in particular local authorities who, as I said earlier, have that lead role in engaging with local communities to understand the needs and to provide additional resources if required. Doing what we all can to prepare our homes, our families and our communities for the disruption that can come from emergencies can make a huge difference. And I do want to once again point to the government's ready.scot website, where there is plenty advice for the public on how to be as prepared as possible. And I think the other imperative lesson that we've learned in recent times is that flooding doesn't just occur in areas that have a history of flooding, and you know there is an exercise to undertake to raise awareness that flooding can indeed affect any individual or any community at any potential time.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and apologies to the member I was unable to squeeze in. That concludes the ministerial statement. There will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow front bench teams to change positions should they wish. Thank you.